Hey folks, welcome to yet another interesting yet important video lecture on engineering mathematics. This is engineering mathematics lecture 8. I'm your course instructor Utkarsh Upadhyay. Hopefully you are all doing great and continuously revising the concepts that I covered in the last 7 lectures. With the end of the 7th lecture, I concluded linear algebra. So in this lecture, I'm going to start a new chapter which is called as calculus. Calculus has got the hell lot of importance, just like linear algebra in gate examination or IES or PSU or IIT MTech interviews. So it's totally up to you to not miss this subject, this chapter, if you're preparing for gate or IES. You can expect at least 2 to 3 questions in the examination. Okay. If you really like the video, please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. If you have any doubts, please write them down in the comment section below. We shall surely get back to you with the solutions, or if required, we can make a separate video on that. Okay? Let me start with the new chapter called calculus. Okay? I'm starting this lecture with the most important topics, for that is basically limits, and then we shall move on to the continuity, differentiability, maxima minima, differentiation and integration. Okay, Taylor series, Maclaurin series and so on and so forth. So first of all, let's start with the right and the left hand limits. Okay. So if x approaches a from right, so if x approaches a, let's say a any number from right, from larger value of x than a, and the limit of f as defined before of any function f is called the right hand limit. Okay, which is basically defined as limit when x tend to a plus f of x, or you can write it as f of a plus 0, or limit of x tend to a plus 0 f of x. This is how you define the right hand limit of a function f of x. Okay, if you make some changes here, we can also write this thing as limit x tend to h, x tends to, sorry, limit h tends to 0 f of a plus h. Okay, we have now replaced x with a plus h, so x is equal to a plus h. We can also write this thing like this: limit h tend to 0 f of a plus h. This is the definition for right hand limit. For the left hand limit, when basically x is less than a, when x is less than a and approaches a from the left side, then the limit of function f is defined as limit x tend to a minus f of x, or f of a minus 0, or limit x tend to a minus 0 f of x. Okay, now we basically replace this thing x with a minus h. Let's replace x with a minus h. So then we get limit h tend to 0 f of a minus h. This is also your left hand limit. Okay, I think these two things are quite clear to you. So right hand limit is nothing but limit h tend to 0 f of a plus h. So from these two expressions, it's quite tacit that we are talking about left hand limit and right hand limit. Okay, there are some formulas you should know. There are some formulas of some functions that you should know, because if you encounter any question which consists of finding out the limit of a particular function and requires the expansion of that particular function, then you do not feel confused at that time. You do not find yourself in dilemma. So there are some various formulas that I'm going to write here that you should know. So these are basically the Taylor series expansions of different functions, some important functions. So I will discuss the Taylor series and Maclaurin series later, but for the time being, you should remember these formulas. 1 plus x to the power n, the Taylor series or the binomial expansion, is equal to 1 plus nx plus n into n minus 1 upon 2 factorial x square plus n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 divided by 3 factorial x cube, and so on and so forth. 1 minus x to the power minus 1 is 1 plus x square plus x cube, and so on and so forth. A to the power x is 1 plus x log to the base e of a plus x to the square by 2 factorial log a to the power square plus x cube by 3 factorial log a whole cube, and so on and so forth. We have then e to the power x is equal to 1 plus x plus x square by 2 factorial plus x cube by 3 factorial, and so on and so forth. We have then sin x, which is x minus x cube by 3 factorial plus x to the power 5 by 5 factorial, and so on and so forth. Then we have cos x, which is 1 minus x square by 2 factorial plus x to the power 4 by 4 factorial, and so on and so forth. Okay. Then we have 10x, which is x plus x cube by 3 plus 2 by 15 x to the power 5, and so on and so forth. Then we have log of 1 plus x, which is x minus x square by 2 plus x cube by 3 minus x to the power 4 by 4 plus, and so on and so forth, for mod x less than 1. Log 1 minus x is minus times of x plus x square by 2 plus x cube by 3 plus x to the power 4 by 4, and so on and so forth, for mod x less than 1. Sine inverse x is x plus x cube by 6 plus 3 x to the power 5 divided by 40, and so on and so forth. Tan inverse of x is x minus x cube by 3 plus x to the power 5 by 5 minus, and so on and so forth. Okay. Sine hyperbolic x is x plus x cube by 3 factorial plus x to the power 5 by 5 factorial, and so on and so forth. The last one, cos hyperbolic x, is 1 plus x square by 2 factorial plus x to the power 4 by 4 factorial, and so on and so forth. Okay, but you should remember that log 1 is 0, log e is 1, log infinity is infinity, and log 0 is minus infinity. There's important formulas of the logarithm, natural log. There are some useful results so you should be well versed with these formulas. Okay, just put the heading some important. There are some very important results. If you don't take care of these formulas in the while solving problem, you may end up getting wrong results, which is not desired in the examination. First one is limit when x tends to 0, sine x by x is always 1. Second, limit when x tends to 0, cos x is always 1. Third, limit when x tends to 0, tan x by x is always 1. Fourth, limit x tends to 0, 1 plus x to the power 1 by x is e. Fourth, limit x tends to 0, 1 plus nx, 1 by x is e to the power n. Sixth, limit x tends to infinity, 1 plus 1 by x, x is e. Seventh, limit when x tends to infinity, 1 plus a by x to the power of x is e to the power a. There are some important formulas that you should know before proceeding to solving questions. Okay. Now let's have a look at some indeterminate forms that you may encounter in the in some questions. So how to deal with them? So while solving the question, you may end up getting some indeterminate forms. Applying the limit to which may not result into the desired answer, and which is incorrect. If you do some mistake, you might end up getting the wrong results, which is not desired in the examination. So let's discuss about the determinate indeterminate forms and how can we deal with them. Okay, so when you apply a limit to a certain function which is given to you, and if it turns out to be in the one of these forms, infinity by infinity or infinity minus infinity or 0 into infinity or 1 to the power of infinity or 0 to the power 0 or infinity to the power 0. These are basically the indeterminate forms. And if you basically encounter while solving the limit question in the examination, then how to deal with these indeterminate forms? How to get the result? So we deal the indeterminate forms by L'Hopital rule or L'Hopital rule. Okay, it's just basically the differentiation of the numerator and denominator. Differentiation of numerator and denominator, unless you get a certain definite form. Okay, so you have to differentiate numerator and denominator unless you get a definite form out of it. Okay, so let's discuss these limits one by one. So first, indeterminate form which is basically your 0 by 0 or infinity divided by infinity. The first indefinite form, so let's say if f of x and let's say phi of x be two functions, such that indeterminate form will exist only if, let's say, limit x tend to a f of x is equal to 0 and limit x tend to a phi of x is equal to 0 or limit x tend to a f of x is turning out to be infinity and limit x tend to a phi of x is also turning out to be infinity, then limit x tend to a f of x over phi of x is also equal to limit x tend to a f dash of x over phi dash of x. So we have basically applied the L'Hopital rule. Okay. Second indeterminate form. Second indeterminate form is basically 0 multiplied with infinity. Okay. So we have to basically reduce this form of indeterminate form into 0 by 0 or infinity by infinity. For example, let's say limit x tend to a f of x, let's say 0, and limit x tend to a phi of x is infinity. Then what we can do, we can write limit x tend to a f of x into phi of x as limit x tend to a f of x divided by 1 by phi of x. So it's basically of the form, 0 by 0. It's basically of the form 0 by 0. So you can say 1 by infinity is 0, f of x is 0. So it has been reduced to this indeterminate form, the first indeterminate form that we solved. And after this, limit can be solved by applying the L'Hopital rule. Okay? Understood? Or you can also write limit x tend to a phi of x 1 by f of x, which is nothing but of the form infinity divided by infinity. And after that, use L'Hopital rule. So your main aim should be to convert the given indeterminate form into 0 by 0 or infinity by infinity. Let's discuss the third indeterminate form. Third indeterminate form is basically 0 to the power 0 or 1 to the power infinity or infinity to the power of 0. So let's say, let limit x tend to a f of x to the power of phi of x takes any of these forms. Okay, let limit x tend to a f of x to the power of phi of x takes any of these forms. And let's say y is equal to limit x tend to a f of x to the power of phi of x. We have to, our main aim should be to convert this indeterminate form into 0 by 0 or infinity by infinity so that we can apply the L'Hopital rule. So now take log on both the sides. So we get log y phi of x, so limit x tend to a phi of x log f of x. Okay, so we can easily say that this is converted into a zero. So this can be written into this can have the form 0 into infinity if it has the form 0 into infinity. We can easily convert it to 0 by 0 or infinity divided by infinity form and then apply L'Hopital rule. Okay, so now let's try to dive deep into the clarity of these concepts that I have just covered by solving some examples. So I think you are now familiar with the indeterminate forms that I have discussed here. Whenever you encounter infinity by infinity, infinity minus infinity, 0 into infinity, 1 to the power infinity, 0 to the power 0, infinity to the power 0, or 0 by 0 form, there is one more, 0 by 0 form. So then just you have to follow these three basic rules and you may you will end up getting the correct results. Let's solve some examples based on these concepts. Let's have a look at these examples and let's solve them one by one. The first question says a limit x tend to 0 sine 2 by 3x by x. Okay. So if we just apply, so you can see that limit x tend to 0 sine 2 by 3 x divided by x. When we put 0, it's basically a 0 by 0 form, indeterminate form. So we simply apply your L'Hopital rule, which is equal to limit x tend to 0. It will be equal to sine 2 by 3 x divided by x, or this will be equal to, if we apply differentiate this thing, limit x tend to 0, this will be equal to sine 2 by 3 of x will be equal to cos 2 by 3 of x into 2 by 3 divided by 1. If we put 0, we get 2 by 3 as the answer. So answer to this is 2 by 3. The B question, limit x tend to infinity x plus sine x divided by x. So it's basically, let's reduce this thing up. Limit x tend to infinity x plus sine x divided by x. This can be written as limit x tend to infinity 1 plus sine x divided by x. This is an indeterminate form. What we can do with this? We can say this is will be equal to 1 plus, because this is distributive, limit 1 plus sine x by x tend to infinity. So if we apply the L'Hopital rule, it will turn out to be 0. This will be equal to 1. So answer to this is 1. Because less x tend to infinity is sine x by x is 1. Okay. C. Limit alpha tends to 0. Alpha tends to 0. X to the power alpha minus 1 divided by alpha. So that's basically an indeterminate form, because if we put 0 in this, x to the power 0 is 1, 1 minus 1 is 0 divided by 0. It's an indeterminate form. Let's apply the L'Hopital rule. Limit alpha tends to 0. You get alpha x to the power alpha minus 1 divided by 1. Okay. If we apply alpha as 0, we get, so if we apply alpha to the power of this thing, we get, is a correction, it is not true, because it's x to the power alpha, we are differentiating with respect to alpha. This will turn out to be limit alpha tends to 0. If you just differentiate x to the power alpha, it is equal to x to the power alpha ln alpha, okay, divided by 1. If we apply alpha is equal to 0, we know that it will be equal to ln x. Okay, alpha tends to 0 is x to the power 0 is 1, and ln x is left. So ln x is the answer. Let's have a look at the fourth question. What does it say? Limit x tend to 3. x square minus 7x plus 3 divided by 5x square minus 12x minus 9. Now keenly observe, if we just plug 3 in these two equations, we get 0 by 0 of indeterminate, 0 by 0 indeterminate form. So just apply the L'Hopital rule. What do we get? Limit x tends to 3. This will be equal to 4x minus 7 divided by 10x minus 12. So 12 minus 7 divided by 30 minus 12, it will be equal to 5 divided by 18 is the answer. Okay. Let's look at the next question. E question says, limit x tend to 0 e to the power x minus 1 plus x square by 2 divided by x cube. Okay, this is also an indeterminate form of the 0 by 0. Okay, if we just plug x is equal to 0 in this equation, you get 1 minus of 1, which is 0, divided by 0. Just apply the L'Hopital rule, you get limit x tend to 0. If we just differentiate, e to the power x, differentiation is e to the power x minus 0, 1 plus x divided by 3x square. Okay, this is again an indeterminate form. We can further reduce it. Again apply your L'Hopital rule. we get e to the power x minus 1 divided by 6x. Again, an indeterminate form, we can further reduce it, x tend to 0, e to the power x divided by 6. So, answer to this is 1 by 6. This will be your answer. Okay, let's have a look at the F question. Limit x tend to 4 sine x minus 4 divided by x minus 4. Okay, if we basically replace let h is equal to x minus 4, then if x tend to 4, h will tend to 0. Okay, so this limit can be written as limit h tend to 0 sine h divided by h. And we know this is equal to 1. So 1 is the answer to this question. Let's have a look at the next question, G question. Okay, the question says limit x tends to infinity square root of x square plus x minus 1 minus x. Now, how to solve this thing? So, it's basically, we cannot determine the answer to this because it's of the form infinity minus infinity. This is of the form infinity minus infinity. What we can do with this? We can try to use the rationalization. Let's try to rationalize this function, this thing. It will be equal to limit x tends to infinity square root of x square plus x minus 1 minus x multiplied with square root of x square plus x minus 1 plus x divided by square root of x square plus x minus 1 plus x. Whenever you see a square root being used in the limit question, just rationalize it. If it is turning out into a indeterminate form, okay, this will be equal to a minus b into a plus b is a square minus b square. This will be equal to x square plus x minus 1 minus x square divided by square root of x square plus x minus 1 plus x. This will cancel. What are we left with is x minus 1 square root of x square plus x minus 1 plus x. Okay. Now, what else can we do from in this thing is, let's take x square out of this square root. We get limit x tend to infinity. You get x minus 1 square root. We just take x square out of this. You get x square root of 1 plus 1 by x minus 1 by x square minus plus x. Okay. This will be equal to limit x tend to infinity 1 by, so it will be equal to 1 minus 1 by x divided by square root of, this is plus 1 here, since we have taken x out of this term, so you get 1 plus 1 by x minus 1 by x square plus 1. Okay, now we can easily put x tend to infinity in this. So if you put, we get 1 minus 1 by infinity square root of 1 plus 1 by infinity plus 1 by infinity square plus 1. Okay, we get 1 upon square root 1 plus 1, which is equal to 1 by 2. So answer to this question is 1 by 2. Let's have a look at one more example. Suppose you need to find out the limit x tend to infinity x to the power of 1 by x. It's of the form infinity to the power of infinity. How can we solve that? Okay. So, let y is equal to limit x tend to infinity x to the power of 1 by x. So, it's basically of the form infinity to the power of 0, which is an indeterminate form. So, how can we solve that? Let's apply log on both the sides. Log on both the sides. Okay. If we apply here, we get limit x tend to infinity, we get 1 by x log x. Okay. Now, log of infinity is infinity and x is also infinity, so that's basically an indeterminate form. How can we solve that? So this log of 1 by x of this thing can be written. So this is basically of the form, this term is basically of the form infinity by infinity. Applying L'Hopital rule, as simple, log y is equal to limit x tend to infinity, log of x is 1 by x and x ka differentiation will be equal to 1 and 1 by infinity is 0. So we can say, since log y is equal to 0, y comes out to be e to the power 0, which is 1. So answer to this question is 1. Okay, so this is, I suggest you to open any gate book or any book that you have and solve as many questions as you can based on the limits. Okay, we are now basically heading towards one more topic of discussion, which is very, very important, which is, that is referred to as continuity and differentiability. Okay, so I'm now going to discuss about continuity. I think this is also a very, very important topic, and you must have come across this particular topic when you were in your 11th and 12th standard. So let's quickly revise the basic concepts behind continuity and differentiability, which you need to know before proceeding to the questions. So a function f of x is said to be continuous at any point A if and only if, first point, f of A, that is the value at that particular, the value of fx at x is equal to A is a definite number. Okay, and second point, the limit of the function f of x at x is equal to A exists and is equal to the value of f of x at x is equal to A. Okay, so we can say that limit at x is equal to A f of x must be equal to f of A for the function to be continuous at the point x is equal to A. Okay, also this can be more generalized to the left hand limit and right hand limit must be equal to the value of that function at that point. Okay, left hand limit should be equal to right hand limit should be equal to f of A, then only the function is said to be continuous at that point, at any arbitrary point x is equal to A. Okay, so we also talk about continuity of the function in the open interval, let's say AB. Continuity of the function in an open interval AB. A function is said to be continuous in the open interval AB if and only if it is continuous at each point of the open interval. This is continuous if and only if it is continuous at each point in the open interval AB. Okay, second one is continuity of the function in the closed interval AB. Okay, in the closed interval AB. So function is said to be continuous if and only if, this is possible if and only if, it is continuous from right at A okay, and continuous from left at B, okay, and third, continuous in the open interval A and B. For example, if we just talk of this particular closed interval, let's say A and B, this is basically your f of x. Then the value at x is equal to A must be equal to the right-hand limit about x is equal to A. Okay, which I meant to say that f of A should be equal to limit x tend to A plus f of x. And f of B must be equal to limit x tend to B minus f of x. And it should be continuous in this interval, in the open interval A comma B. Then only it will be said to be continuous in the closed interval AB. Understood? So the function value at x is equal to B should be equal to the limit of the function when x tend to B minus just before B and just after A, for all the values greater than A, for all the values less than B, and should be continuous in the open interval AB. Then only it will be set continuous in the closed interval A and B. Understood? Okay. I hope that continuity concept is clear to you. Let's study about the differentiability. Once I cover these two topics, I will solve questions based on these concepts. Okay. Now let's now talk of the differentiability. A function f of x is said to be differentiable in the open interval AB. A function is said to be differentiable in the open interval, remember, interval A and B in any value R, and let differentiable in R if and only if limit h tend to 0 f of x naught plus h minus f of x naught divided by h is equal to limit x tend to x naught f of x minus f of x naught divided by x minus x naught. Okay, where x naught belong to any integer value, then only it is said to be differentiable, and this thing is denoted by f prime of x naught. This is denoted by f prime of x naught. So for example, let's say we have this function. Let's say this point is x. Okay, let's say this point is x naught, and this let's say this point is x. If we plot the curve between f of x and x, let's say this is x naught and this is x, and the distance between the two, let's say, is h. So from here we can say that x is nothing but x naught plus h. So another way of writing this derivative is this. Okay, another way of writing this derivative is this. You just replace x with x naught plus h, you get x naught plus h minus f of x naught, and x minus x naught is h. And if x tends to x naught, h will tend to 0. Then only it is said to be differentiable. For the convincing results, we find out the left hand derivative and the right hand derivative. Okay, let's just find out for the convincing results. We find out left hand and right hand derivatives. Okay, so left, so for example, we just talk about the right hand derivative, which is RHD. Okay, limit h tend to 0 f of x naught plus h minus f of x naught divided by h is what referred to as a right hand derivative. It is basically denoted by R f of f prime of x naught or f prime of x naught plus h, or you can also denote it by f prime of x naught plus, and the left hand derivative is limit h tend to 0 f of x naught minus f of x naught minus h divided by minus h, where h is positive number. This thing is denoted by L f dash of x naught or f prime of x naught minus h, or you can say f prime of x naught minus. If these two derivatives are equal and also equal to the derivative at that particular point x naught, then the function is said to be differentiable. Okay? So we basically come across the two important subtopics is basically differentiability in an open interval. Differentiability in an open interval. So function f is said to be differentiable in the open interval, let's say a, b, if it is differentiable at each point in differentiable if and only if it is differentiable at each point in an open interval AB. Okay, a function then is said to be differentiable. Let's just talk about the differentiability of a function in a closed interval, let's say AB, in a closed interval. So function f, is said to be differentiable in a closed interval A and B if and only if it is, let's have three points here, differentiable from right at A, okay, differentiable from right at A, that is R right hand derivative of f dash of A exists, and second point, differentiable from left at B, that is left hand derivative of f prime B exists, and third point, it is differentiable at every point in the open interval A and B. This is how it goes. For example, if we have this function, let's say these are the two points A and B. A function should be so in this case, you can see that the right hand derivative, right hand derivative at x is equal to a should exist, and the left hand derivative at x is equal to b should exist. There should not be any discontinuity, and a function is differentiable throughout. A function is differentiable at every point between a and b. Okay, so I want to make a point here which is very, very important. Okay, you can just note it down. Note, if a function is continuous, if a function is differentiable, then it is necessary that the function is continuous. Function is continuous at that point. But the converse may or may not be true. So we can say differentiability implies continuity, but continuity may or may not apply differentiability. Okay, these two points are really, really important. Okay, folks, I'm stopping this lecture here. This was basically a brief, very detailed introduction to continuity, differentiability, and limits. In the next lecture, I will start off with some important question. Till then, please revise all the concepts that I covered in the last 7 to 8 lectures. And if you find yourself in a frenzy and dilemmatic situation and a dubious situation, please write your doubts down in the comment section below. We shall surely get back to you with the solutions. Do not deter your doubts to come out of your mouth or to come out through your hands and to be written down in the comments. If you don't write them down, if you don't tell us your doubts, we shall not be able to help you because we cannot read your minds. Okay? Please do not suppress your doubts within yourself. Even if the doubt is so small and so basic, we shall surely help you with those as well. Okay? Thank you very much.